Thank you. Everyone, glad to see you here. Glad to have you here. I don't see you, but you see me. But I'm imagining you. I'm seeing as many of you as I can in my mind. And I'm looking forward to a time in the not too distant future where we'll start gathering. Maybe we'll gather in small groups. Maybe we'll have some special occasions to have a worship service outside. That's kind of what we're thinking about now as the season gets a little cooler and we can be more spaced out and safe with one another. But I hope you're well. And it's good to hear from you as I do online, emails, texts. And in our Zoom meetings, it's really good to be with you. Hope you're well. Listen, this morning, if you're with us, as you're with us, you're obviously with us, register your attendance, please. You'll see it there on the side. Also, you'll see a button for online giving. We so appreciate that. The church continues in its ministries. In fact, in its outreach ministries, the church is involved exponentially right now, as you can imagine, in giving and helping and services to others. But the church continues in its ministry in all ways, locally and abroad, so we appreciate your continued offering that sustains this ministry. Also, if you're with us for the first time, register attendance, give us an address. Let me know you're there so we can send you one of these, our special gift, Sip, Breathe, Smile. This relates to what we're going to talk about a little bit later on. 1111 logo. We'd love to send you one of these tumblers. Also, we have one of these masks. Our own branded, Brian Jolin branded face mask, 1111. Love to send you one of these. I believe it's 2-ply and comfortable. And we all need an assortment as we're experiencing now. We need an assortment so we can be stylish in different ways. So love to send you one of those. I hope you're well this morning. We're gonna have three songs. I'm gonna share I'm gonna share in between each song, just a short bit. And so we're gonna have some fun with this, some stories. So stick around. It's going to be great. It's going to be a little bit different this morning. And then let's keep in touch, and we will see you soon. Blessings.
Okay, our neighbors are stopping as they walk this evening and wondering, what are these weird guys doing? Are they having a seance? We're not really sure. The welcome candle is lit. Please recite the words along with us if you know them. Come, come whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving, it does not matter. Ours is not a caravan of despair. Come, even if you have broken your vows 1,000 times. Come yet again.
Holy One, I just want to say something about September. It seems to me that September is that time when summer and fall stand side by side, pulling in opposite directions, each one gaining and each one losing ground. The sun's heat melts the wax of our pumpkin spice candles that we put out way too soon. And some days the cooler and bluer sky outmans the sun. This push and pull of competing days makes me think that it's a reminder that life is give and take and give, and not always pleasant. Our ideals become idols, and our idols become ideals, and sometimes we struggle to know which is which, and it's exhausting. And still, life entices us, calls us into the fray, which is all of us, and shouts, breathe it in, drink it up, and spend all of your tears and all of your sweat for the love of it. Amen.
All right, that was awesome, Brad. Brad, you guys are always bringing it. That is such a great song, Modern Love, and you guys did it again. You always bring this great cover, these great songs. Awesome. Thanks so much for that. Sharm, thank you for your prayer because it really resonates with where we're going this morning. Look, we're going to talk about modern love, but more than anything, I want to talk about this idea of love is a labor of love. Life is a labor of love as we think through this holiday or this weekend, with the holiday weekend we're on, Labor Day weekend. I'm going to start with the story of foolish wisdom. One of my favorite wisdom sources of wisdom tales comes from this Middle Eastern fool. His name is Nasruddin Hoca, 13th century populist philosopher of Turkey, and basically a teacher of Sufism, of the mystic tradition of Sufism, essentially. And so everyone considers him a fool because of his counterintuitive way of approaching insights and wisdom. One day, he goes to a teacher. He decides he wants to learn how to play a musical instrument. So he goes to his teacher and he says to his teacher, "How much to learn how to play the lute?" The teacher says, 2 silver pieces for the first lesson, 1 silver piece for the second. And he says, "Awesome, great, I'll start with the second lesson." So he only needs one lesson. He's sure that he's a great musician at that point. He turns to his teacher and says, "I got it." And he takes his lute and leaves his class and goes out to the middle of the square in the marketplace. Lots of noise, people talking, people selling and buying, chaos and such. And in the midst of all that noise, he picks up his instrument and he begins to play this one note on a string, single note on the fret there, and he starts plucking. Plink, 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 plink. After about 5 or 10 minutes, he closes his eyes as if he's enraptured. Plink, 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 plink. And he goes on and on and on. Until after a while, people begin to hear this annoying sound that seems to be permeating all the other noises, all the other chaos. And one by one by one, people quiet down, they turn to see the source of the noise, and they turn to see Nasruddin Hoca playing this one instrument, the lute, playing this one note. Pling, 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 pling. Finally, someone gets the courage, they walk up to him, they muffle the strings and say, "Nasruddin, what are you doing?" And he smiles and says, "I'm playing this instrument." "You're not playing an instrument." She says, "Yes, I'm playing the lute." They said, "No, you are destroying the lute." He says, "No, I beg to differ. I am a master of this instrument." They said, "No, no, no, we've heard masters of this instrument. They play melodious, beautiful notes and songs, notes up and down the neck. How do you explain yourself as a master when that's what a real master does?" He says, "Oh, it's simple. All of those other musicians are looking for this one note." Right? You get what we're talking about here, right? You understand, you see what's being said here, don't you? It's as if Jesus were saying, if you want to find your life, you have to lose your life. If you want to gain, you have to learn to let go and lose. If you want to experience compassion, you have to be compassion. If you want to find God, if you want to find the divine, you find that when you care for others. He said, "Care for others, you're caring for me," he said. It's this interesting counterintuitive idea. What is the one note that everyone's looking for? When often in 11:11, we've often talked about this, where if we all just had a shirt, we could wear this shirt and it would be true for all of us, right? It would simply say, "Love me." Right? It would just have written on it, "Love me." Because that's really, in essence, what we all want. That's really what we were all created for. Science has shown we're created for connection, which makes this time we're in so profoundly difficult, doesn't it? We're made for connection, and yet we're seeing connection turned back, pushed away in every turn. Not simply because it's hard to be connected when we have safe distancing, but it's hard to be connected when we find other people who don't seem to be practicing that same consideration for safety, right? Not when the not wearing masks, you know, being close. We find this sort of distrust now in all of in so many different settings that we're in the midst of the reality that we have this disease that requires that we don't be in close connection. It's so challenging for us. And so this idea of this one note makes it even all the more profound. So I want to talk with you about this idea of labor of love and how we find the essence of what is this one thing that we are all looking for. Rob Bell has this great story that he tells about, if you listen to Rob Bell, he's got a great podcast called The Robcast, and it's long, at least it runs about an hour each time, but it's really fun. It's great. Turn it on, listen, always good insights. And recently he was talking about a friend that he ran into whose in the midst of this chaos like the rest of us. I like to call it COVID 2020 instead of COVID-19 because I thought 2020 would be the year we could see things more clearly, right? We could begin to right wrongs. We could bring justice to injustice. We could begin to see things. But instead, what we've got is this disease which has thrown us into chaos, and our culture's into chaos, and our economy into chaos. And everything has been now defined by COVID 2020 when we can't have funerals. We have to have limited funerals. We can't have weddings. They're limited weddings. The way in which we celebrate life, the rituals with which we celebrate life as community, all those things have been redefined by COVID. And then we're going to find that the church is being redefined by COVID. And we're going to find that a lot of our economy and our reality has been redefined because of this experience. But here's the thing. Can we still see clearly? Can we still see what this possibility, what is possible in all of this chaos? So Rob Bell tells this great story about seeing this friend who's talking about these challenges she's faced, this chaos that she's been facing. And he says to her, she's talking about how things have been kind of bad. And then he stops and he says, it's good to be you. He tells her, it's good to be you. And it stops her short, takes her back. She looks at him curiously and then she starts to smile. She said, oh, I so needed to hear that. I really needed to hear that. It's good to be me. I need to write that down. She wrote it down on a piece of paper with pen. She wrote it again. And then he said, wait, put your name there. It's good to be Jenny. It's good to be Jenny. It's good to be, I don't know what her name was, but it's good to be Jenny. And she wrote it a dozen times. And the more she wrote it, he said, the more this demeanor took on this, she took on this demeanor of sort of a joy, sort of a calmness from what she had brought, the anxiety she brought to the moment. I don't know how that would work. I would love to try that. I've been meeting with many of you from time to time throughout this time and having socially distanced meetings and then on the phone and in Zoom meetings. And I wonder how that would affect you. It's good to be you. Right now, where you are, it's good to be you. Some of us could hear that because things are all, it's been pretty good and we're not doing too bad. And it's hard and we've lost some of our retirement, but we're doing all right and we're going to be fine. Some of us have experienced disease and death and illness much more personally, and it has been challenging at the very least, if not reframing our reality. We've experienced loss. We've experienced hurt and pain. Some of us have lost jobs, and we've experienced the challenge of that and the chaos of that. How do you say it's good to be me in the midst of that? And yet, something at the core of us has to recognize it's good to be us. Ross Gay, in his book, The Book of Delights, somebody asked him once in an interview, said, how can you talk about delight in a time of misery? This was actually a couple of years ago, but it was still a very divisive, binary, tribalistic, kind of hateful reality we've been in. And they said, how can you even talk about delight in a time like this? And he smiled. He says, if ever you can talk about a delight in any kind of time, it should be this time that we're in now. He would say that even now, if there was ever a time for talking about delight, it is now. If there's ever been a time for finding delight, it is now. It's good to be you. So if you go to the book of Genesis, one of my favorite stories is the creation story. And now, I used to be evangelical and fundamentalist, and I used to think, well, that was it. I was creationist. Life started 7 days. In 7 days, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 years ago, right? I used to think that. But now, I love the story for the profound truth that it tells. Like so many of the biblical stories, like so many of the New Testament teachings of Jesus, the profound truths that these biblical narratives speak to. Contradictions, yes. Inconsistencies, yes. Downright out and out bad practices, yes. It's all there, just like the church, just like in David Bowie's song, God and Religion, church, God and church and man. I mean, all these things, interpersonal relationships, romantic relationships, ideals fall apart. We hold them up there, but they fall apart. Ideals are always in contrast to what's real. But you don't give up because there's wisdom in the midst of that chaos. So the Genesis story has this great teaching. At the very beginning, it created 7 days, right? But if you go to the very beginning story, Spirit is hovering over the chaos. Here, Spirit is hovering over the void and the chaos. And then out of that chaos, there's a story that says, God created light out of this darkness. And then God said, it is good. And then there's day two and day three and day four. And I even love the story because there's chaos and inconsistency in the story. You got first day and night being created after light and dark. You know, you've got all these kind of things in and out of order. But even in that, God says, it is good. So there's something about spirit always hovering over chaos. There's something about creativity in the midst of disorder. Richard Rohr talks about order in life and then disorder and then reorder, reorientation. And that's really what life is about, this kind of chaos. And in the midst of that chaos, spirit is hovering. Well, I love that image, that metaphor, because out of that, God says, it is good. Life out of the midst of chaos becomes something. It is good. In all of this chaos that we are in now, something will happen. And what do we say? It is good. Now we may, you know, Rob Bell does this wonderful thing. He says, how do you tell your story? Do you begin with Genesis 1 or do you begin with Genesis chapter 3? And we know that story. That's the second creation story that we're familiar with. It's not the only one. There were bunches of creation stories, but it's the second one in the Bible. And it says that it was the Adam and Eve story that basically first man, first woman were cast out of paradise because they tried to grasp the tree of knowledge of good and evil, right? Don't do that. Don't eat of that. And yet that's what they were all about. They were all about grasping. They were all about trying to control. They were all about trying to take control of things, attach to things. And in the process of that, God says, you know, that's not paradise. But we think of paradise as it's this perfect place. It's this other place. Jesus said the kingdom of God is in our midst. In the Gospel of Thomas, to turn up a stone, that's where you find divinity. You find the divine, you find the sacred. Look behind the bush, you'll find it there. It's like it's in the midst of everything. The kingdom of God, this connectedness, this possibility in the midst of the chaos is there. We talk about it as shalom, is what we've been talking about all this time in COVID time, is this idea of shalom, this seeking towards balance and wholeness, which is always a process of imbalance, but that in itself is paradise. It's not out there. It's not ideal. You know, in fact, even David Bowie's song is a great illustration of how this song is this tension between what's possible and what seems impossible. And yet the song has this playfulness to it, right? It's like Zorba the Greek dancing over the grave of his good friend who died. You know, it's sort of like dancing over death. It's like in the midst of the chaos is some kind of possibility. So how do you begin your story? Do you begin it with, no, it's broken. It's bad. Cast out. It's over there. I'll never get it. Or I'll keep trying to get it, but I'm never going to get it. What happens when we always seek for that one note out beyond us is that we're never satisfied. We're always seeking. We're always seeking beyond ourselves for it when it's within ourselves. The old idea that you have to love yourself before you can love someone else. What Paul Tillich said, that salvation, Paul Tillich, the theologian, said salvation is simply... not simple, it's hard, but it is simply the process of accepting our acceptance. It's good to be you. In the midst of all of this, it's good to be you. So do you start your story with that? Do you start your story with Genesis 1 or Genesis 3? It's just broken. I come from a broken family. I come from an alcoholic family. I come from an abused relationship. How do you define your narrative? And then how do you tell your narrative? And then even more importantly, in times like these, how do you tell your narrative? Is it from that perspective of, can't wait to see what's happening? What's possible? I want to participate in what's possible, right? I want to participate in what's creatively possible right now. Or do you tell it from the perspective of, it's just one more broken thing. It's just one more disaster. It's just one more crisis. My life is miserable in the midst of this. I mean, how we tell our narrative in this time is profoundly definitive of what's next, I think. I think that's what we're looking at. So what does love have to do with that? Well, I think that is exactly what is at the very heart of what it means to be in love. And so I want to suggest this quote from Brené Brown before we go to this song, this second song that Brad's going to do. In her book, The Gift of Imperfection, she writes, "The dark does not destroy the light, it defines it. It's our fear of the dark that casts our joy into the shadows. The dark does not destroy the light, it defines it. But our fear of the dark casts joy to the shadows." Fear is kind of the basis of a lot of our idealizations, right? Patriotism, the flag, church, all these ideals that we hold up, they become unreal. And so we even lock into them more intensely with piety and rigidity and legalisms, because it's all rooted in fear, right? Fear does not define it. Fear casts the joy out. Literally, like we're cast out of the garden. But when we let go of that fear, when we're more vulnerable, as Brené Brown would say, when we're more present and real to the moment, more confessional even, if you will, to where we are in the moment, we begin to experience the kingdom in our midst. We begin to experience that reality that it's good to be us. Brad, give us this next song.
The words I have to say may well be simple, but they're true. Until you give your love, there's nothing more than we can do. Love is the opening door. Love is what we came here for. No one could offer you more. Do you know what I mean? Have your eyes really seen? You see, it's very hard to leave behind the life we knew. But there's no other way, and now it's really up to you. Love is the key we must have. Love is the flame we must burn. Freedom, the lesson we must learn. Do you know what I mean? Have your eyes really seen? Love is the opening door. Love is what we came here for. No one could offer you more. Do you know what I mean? Have your eyes really seen? Have your eyes really seen?
I love that song. I really love that song. We've sung that song as a congregation many times, as also as a special Elton John's love song. It doesn't sound like Elton John. I always laugh. It sounds like something more out of the 60s. But then, of course, it came out of the 70s, and I think it was early 70s. But this idea of love is the opening door. Love is what we came here for. Do you know what I mean? That's such a great phrase. Do you know what I mean? This is what I think where we find ourselves. Seeking that one note, seeking love at the core of our being. If you look up the word love, it has so many strange associations because of the way in which we idealize the idea of love, that we idealize the idea of romantic love. If you look up the word love, you find the typical definition. It's compassion, it's affection, it's desire in a relationship between two people. But the reality is, it's hard to define. We use it to define all sorts of contexts that we find ourselves in, as contrasted to hate. But that's not really what love is. Love, in fact, is the messiness of relationship. It's how we continue with connection. If you wanted to put that as a definition, I would say love is how we continue with connection in a way that seeks to move connection forward. I'll say it again. Love is how we seek to, is connection and how we seek to move connection forward. Now, if you look up in the online and you find 500 different ways of thinking of love. There's 500 words at least associated with love. I thought this was amazing. So much fun. How do we define love? Infatuation, the opposite of hate, agape, beloved, friendship, affection, emotion, lover, romance, lust, joy, kindness, amorousness, compassion, sexual attraction, love making, Aristotle, sweetheart, intimacy, oxytocin, love, oxytocin. What we find is these words speak to relationship. They speak to how we relate. They speak to how we seek out connection. So what I want to suggest as we wrap up things here is that what love really is this idea of recognizing it is good to be us and then seeking out ways to recognize that in others, to acknowledge that in others. Estrus Tucker last week at the Crafting Difficult Conversations workshop, he made this wonderful insight that I'd really not thought of before, but he said, it's rooted in our Christian tradition, but he said, if you want to have listening that is listening for understanding, listening for transformation, listening without an agenda, if you want to listen in ways that change the encounter, listen in ways that affirm something in the other. So it's not only that you're listening to hear the other person, you're listening for affirmation of the other, for ways in which you can affirm the other. Think of the people you really despise right now. How can you find something to affirm? It seems so counterintuitive. And yet we're all looking for that same connection. We're all looking for that one thing to belong. We just cover it with so much fear, with so much angst and anxiety, with so much idealism to hang on to the fear rather than to let go and experience the joy of connection. Esther Stucker says, listen for a way to find affirmation in the other. Anything that you can affirm in the other. So what I want to suggest is the first thing that we have to learn how to do to experience this goodness of being, to experience love, the labor of love, to participate in it, one thing we have to begin to do is to let go. Let go not just of our conception and our preconceptions about how things should be and our ideals of how things should be, but to let go of the idea of perfection. Imperfection is the ideal. Imperfection is the way of life. You know, you look at life, and up here in northern Michigan, we're getting ready to leave and go back home here in this weekend, but you look at life up here and you see trees are already changing, right? The colors are already starting to change a little bit here and there. Colored light leaves, colorful leaves on the ground, red, yellow. And I'm thinking, how beautiful. And yet, there's this beauty in the breakdown, right? Like the song. Because life is changing. And as life changes, there's beauty. And there's not. There's challenge. There's difficulty. There's loss. But there's beauty. Spirit hovers over the darkness. Something comes out of it. And it's good. First lesson in this labor of love, let go of the ideals. The messiness is the way. The spirit hovers over chaos. But the second lesson I want to leave with you is this idea of how you tell your story. Do you really believe it's good to be you? Maybe practice that. Maybe write it out a few times. Maybe put your name at the end. Maybe look at one another and continue to say it in a way in which you can begin to see past just the silliness of the sound of it or just the almost contradictory feel to it in this present that we're in, that it's good to be in this time that we're in. And yet, that is exactly what the ancient wisdom speaks to. It's good to be in this place, in this time, to be you, to be me. This next song that the band's going to offer us is this song by Michael Fronte called East of the West. And it's basically the idea that love is in all things, right? Love is at the very core of all things. And the hardest part for us to recognize is that love is at the source of the one we see as enemy as much as love is at the source of the one we see as hero or ourselves. Once we let go of the ideals that we continue to cling to, we begin to experience the real and the joy and the delight and the possibility that is at the heart of it. That's the labor of love, is to see that. Blessings on you in this time, and we'll see you soon. Brad?
To the one, but to the air and the freshness we breathe, but to the force of the change in the seasons, but to the mother from which all things come, one to the daughters, one to the sons, but to the father who helps us believe that nothing's ever gonna harm you, see, but to the soldier who walks in the streets, but to the soldier who fights overseas, but to the man who gets down on his knees, prays for God's protection, please. To the east,
upside down.